the fourth one. That's weird.
Yeah, you know, you get that when you have, you know, when you have competing interests within parties, and, right. And you know, obviously two parties, vastly different ideological agendas,
and very close numbers.
Exactly. It's really interesting when you hear about all these Republicans retiring. The Republicans really do have an issue in the House. I mean, I talk to House members. Oh, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. But you know, we're not going to lose the House this year. But I don't know. I mean,
it's close.
And I think you have to like look at what it means if the Republicans lose the House. It means that the fiscal agenda of President Trump becomes a lot more difficult, and it almost becomes.
Do you think that's actually going to happen? I don't see that happening.
The Republicans losing the House?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it depends on who you talk to.
Why I get skeptical about it. Everyone says it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Neil, I agree. I mean, I think if if we had to bet the farm in it today, I'd say, yeah, they'll retain the House, even if narrowly.
But they're going to lose seats, but they're not going to lose 24.
You worry about people like Ileana Ross-Layton leaving. Right. You know, that's going to go to a Democrat probably. Daryl Issa is leaving his seat, although now he may run for the adjacent district, interestingly enough. But all these chairmen, what's happening is these chairmen are being term limited now. You know, they're reaching the limits of their chairmanships. It's not so much fun when you're not a chairman anymore.
Although,
but they can't get party luminaries to run in their place.
Yeah, that's a problem. And if the Republicans do lose the House, remember what happens, sort of the fiscal agenda of President Trump. It shifts much less to taxes and deregulation and stuff like that, much more to like infrastructure and spending of money,
right.
Which gets back to your little bugaboo, which is will there ever be a cap on spending? Will we ever get this under control?
Never.
Here's the one thing I will say. If you have Democrats in the House, probably not, because you're gonna have Trump indulging.
Of it with his, Republicans.
Right, yeah, but Trump, so. Remember, Trump is an odd guy when it comes to ideology.
He can shapeshift.
Yeah, he's a shapeshifter in the sense
that
sometimes he's a Dem, sometimes he's a Republican. He believes in spending. He's advocated almost no spending cuts or sort of containment of entitlements. So he's a big government Republican.
But what are the markets telling you with the futures here up the way they are?
Yeah.
And that could change by tomorrow, obviously. But they're not worried about.
Well, I think that kind of piggybacks on what Charlie's saying is that until there's an incentive for you to tackle spending in some way, and that incentive, I think, logically would come from financial markets. At least that's one of the places it would come from. Then it's going to be tough politically to make that argument, because even if you're the Republicans now, most of their arguments are in favor of more spending on certain things. It might be different than what the Democrats are arguing for. It might be on the military to some degree. It's on infrastructure. But unless interest rates start to tell us that there's an issue here, whether it's for the stock market rally or for the spending debate, I think there won't be an issue.
And stocks like inflation to a certain extent.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, people buy stocks when inflation.
Listen, Bill Miller was talking about if we get over 3% of the 10-year with 255 now, this market's up another 30%.
Right. So, although you start asking yourself, how far above 3% do people say, hey, why should I risk my money in stocks and why don't I just put it away in a bond?
Well, that's
where the markets start to equalize. But right now, I guess markets are looking at, tax cuts, fiscal policy that's expansionary, all that is really good for stocks.
And to Connell's point, they're not looking or seem to care whether they ever get around to entitlement.
Well, I think in an election year, Neil, it's almost impossible politically to do that. It really is. All of this
depends. Any year.
Well, I agree with you, but until we have an electorate, really, truly what it comes down to, if we have an electorate that can understand more than, you know, the short-term perceived benefit of having money spent on them, so to speak.
I think that'll never happen.
Right,
I think
unless they call for fiscal discipline.
One disciplinary aspect of this will be the markets.
Right.
If somehow bond market vigilantes rise up and say, you know, we're going to bail out of the U.S. currency. We're going to sell bonds. We demand a lot more for you to borrow.
We're not at that
We're not at a 2.5 on a 10-year. So maybe it's 3.5 or something. So maybe there's historically, but maybe there's a different level where the conversation changes. But again, that goes back to incentives. It doesn't change till we get to whatever that level is.
And I think we could have a teaching event if a state like Illinois that is deeply, deeply in debt starts defaulting and suffering the consequences, and people can see.
I don't even think that'll do it.
No, well, you know, but how else, you know, how do we make it tangible?
It's hard for states to default.
But you know what I'm saying. They start,
I know what you're
they
saying,
start having
it would
trouble
take a lot to galvanize
funding their
opinion.
Obligations, and right. people can start seeing, well, geez, you know, that would really be bad. But, right. you know, you have
all
to
I know is
moment.
In the latest quarter, the fiscal first quarter of this year, we took in a record amount of money and still had $225 billion in deficits.
Oh, yes. Because,
it's incredible.
Because a representative yeah. democracy like ours, and I know having been a representative, people like to have money spent on them. They like to feel that their representative or their senator is bringing yeah. home the bacon. And as long as they expect that, and as long as politicians respond to those
right.
pressures.
Well, even the immigration debate is that way. It's a trade-off for what? For more spending. For
right.
spending on border security.
Mick Mulvaney
border
would
wall.
Say. Right. He would say, listen,
the budget Mick's, director.
The budget
Mick's smartest
director.
All get out.
He's really smart. But and I've heard him say this. He said, listen, let's get the economy moving 3.5%, 3.5%,
sure.
you know, consecutively, regularly.
Right.
And then let's look at entitlement reform. Because once you get the economy running like that
right.
and you get the tax receipts coming in,
that's
then
right.
you start dealing with that would be a good solution. Now,
that's
do they
right.
have the cojones to do that? Who knows?
You know,
doubtful.